Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How you guys doing? Come on now, there's more than 200 people in here. Good evening. All right, just want to let you know that Talib is in the building. He'll be right outside. Just want to start off with a little introduction. Of course, most of you already know this information, but just for those who don't, if skills sold, Talib Kweli would have been one of the most commercially successful rappers of his time. A Brooklyn native, Talib Kweli Greene is the eldest of two sons born to parents who were both educators. Considering that Arabic translation of Talib Kweli means student of truth, it's obvious that his cerebral and socially relevant approach to MCing was destined from day one. As a child, Kweli was an avid reader and gifted writer. In elementary school, he began writing plays, poetry, and short stories. It wasn't until years later in high school that he turned to hip-hop as an outlet for his self-expression. Through a series of television appearances and successful music albums, he has established himself as a prominent entertainer and activist within the hip-hop community. Tonight's lecture will focus on the anthropology of hip-hop and its impact in a global society. He will also provide his own history in hip-hop, his quest for knowledge, and how his love for hip-hop has honed throughout his years growing up in New York City. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Talib Kweli. How y'all feeling?
Yeah.
First off, I want to apologize for my tardiness. I'm just getting off a plane. I'm navigating all these highways and everything. But I appreciate y'all having me here. I appreciate coming out to St. John's, and I appreciate all y'all coming out. It's a beautiful, wonderful thing. Y'all look wonderful. And, you know, I'm not actually going to lecture y'all. I'm just going to really talk. I'm going to talk at length. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to say some things, talk about my history, talk about hip-hop. Talk about hip-hop as a catalyst for social change and the history of it, but I'm way more interested in the question and answer and having the discourse and having y'all enlighten me, you know what I'm saying? So before I get into any of that, first thing I want to talk about is my history. My name is Talib Kweli Greene. I was born in Brooklyn. Actually, I was born in Brooklyn Jewish Hospital, which is here in Queens, but I grew up in Brooklyn. My parents are Perry and Brenda Greene. They met in New York University in 1969. I was born in 1975. When I was born, my parents moved to Park Slope, Brooklyn. That's where I grew up. That's where I spent the beginning of my life. My father, while he was in college, was a DJ. So he had all this vinyl in the house. Vinyl everywhere. Vinyl just lined up against the walls. Vinyl all in the living room, all in the dining room. My father was a counterculture type when he was growing up. He was like an anti-war protester. My mother was more like into voting rights and joining organizations to empower women. They had very different politics, but their love of activism was what brought them together. And I feel like that's the person I am is as a result of my parents. I'm a perfect blend of all my parents. They were very much into black nationalism, which is the idea that we need to have our own, and that black people in America are a country, or have the potential to be a country within a country, that we have to support our own, and that's the only way to compete. That their idea of black nationalism, it grew into a more, in my opinion, accepting philosophy of Pan-Africanism, which is not just looking at black people in America, but looking at indigenous people and native people who have been oppressed all over the world, people of African descent. And as a result, that's how I got my name, Talib Kweli. My brother's name is Jamal Kwame. I feel like names are important. I feel like I couldn't be no crackhead or be on no ratchet shit if I had a name like Talib Kweli. I've been spending my life trying to live up to my name. You know, and I think it's not just the names though, it's everything. When we were younger, we celebrated Kwanzaa in the house and we had African imagery all over the house. And these are things that started in the home. Any discussion about music or art and how it can affect people, it has to start with the home. And artists, the best artist is a follower of the people. The best artist is a voice of a struggle. You have artists who transcend and become leaders of the people. you know, like Bob Marley, you know, people like that, or Dead Prez, you know, people who put their activism first and then their art. But the vast majority of artists that we celebrate are people who just want to be liked and follow the will of the people. You know, in the 60s when James Brown had Conk and Black Power was in vogue, you know, James Brown felt out of place with his Conk. He had to get an afro, he had to sing, "I'm Black and I'm Proud." You know what I'm saying? Can y'all still hear me?
Yeah.
Right, this mic went down over here. So, you know, he didn't do that because that was like an original thought. He was like, "Oh, I got it." He did that because he was following the will of the people. When the people listen to the radio, a lot of times people complain about what's on the radio. But the radio, the airwaves are owned by y'all, you know? That's why they have to check in with the FCC. Y'all have power over what's being played on the radio. If the type of music that you like is not being played on the radio, you know, it's not necessarily a conspiracy to keep you down, you know what I'm saying? But back to what I was talking about with hip-hop anyway, I grew up listening to the music that my father played in the crib. And then growing up in New York City, I was listening to WPLJ, Z100, pop stations. So I was listening to like Duran Duran, Tears for Fears, and Madonna and stuff like that. But when I got to high school, when I got to junior high school, I went to Summit Junior High School, which was in the 113 building in Brooklyn in Fort Greene. And you know, just peer pressure being in New York City, everything around me was hip hop. Especially what girls was listening to. You know what I'm saying? Like girls was really into hip hop. I was in junior high school like 1988, you know, so this was like Spike Lee Do the Right Thing era, right? Girls were wearing like biker shorts, you know, and they was dancing to hip hop. And this is really what got me into hip hop. Liking to see girls and wanting to be down. This and that. I was already writing, like the brother said, I was writing poetry and plays. But here's a way that I could make the poetry and plays cool. You know what I'm saying? That was in junior high school. When I got to high school, the trend in hip hop was to be conscious, to be aware of your culture, and to represent that in music. And the best MCs of the day, the KRS-Ones, the Rakims, the Big Daddy Kanes, the Chuck D's, these are people who injected culture and a sense of pride into their music. This was a trend, because there was a lot of conscious hip hop that was trendy back then, but that was whack, you know what I'm saying? So you had NWA respond to that by saying, "We niggas with attitudes." Like, NWA music's still conscious. Boys in the Hood is a conscious record. Fuck the Police is a conscious record. But they did it in the lamest terms, instead of like, you know, always having to wear dashiki to prove how conscious you are, which was a lot of rappers was doing, following the trends. The trend of hip hop at that time resonated with me. Not because hip hop is supposed to free the people, and not because, you know, hip hop is a tool, a voice for a struggle. Hip hop is not something that's on the front lines of the struggle. But because it resonated with things that I grew up with in the household. So when we talk about music, we gotta start with that's my point, we gotta start with the house. These things would not have been important to me. I would not have felt like I need to fashion myself after this type of hip hop if it didn't exist in my house. Because when hip hop changed, the vast majority of people who were listening to trendy hip hop when it was conscious changed with it. You know, if you look at hip hop over the last 15 years, the requirement to be a great MC has changed up a lot. When I first came out, like I was saying, you had Big Daddy Kane, Rakim, these guys was 5%. You know what I'm saying? Like, you had Chuck D. These were considered the best. That era moved, then you had like Nas. Nas was supposed to be the second coming of hip hop. Nas had street shit, but he was still super intelligent. You could hear the intellect in his lyrics. Then it became about busting your gun or being a gangster. So if you was considered the best, this is the era of Tupac and Biggie, who are great artists. But a lot of people who came up in that era, in order to feel like they was competing with the best, they had to feel like they was tough or, you know, shoot somebody in the face, you know? Now it's kind of changed now. Now if you think about the people who are the best, people who people consider the best, your Wale's, J. Cole, Kendrick Lamar, people like that, it's a lot more about having fun, you know? It's to be frank, it's a lot of, you know, drinking and partying and having sex, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, release music, you know? But they still nice with it. Like, they approach these subject matters and they still have consciousness, but the vast majority of the lyrics about picking up with it, you know? So these are just things I noticed as a lyricist, which contents what kind of content is in vogue, and how it affects what people think they need to do to be the best. So the content that was in vogue when I first started stayed with me as I went through high school. It stayed with me as I started my career. And I started my career just in Washington Square Park, freestyling, just mastering my craft. Lyricist Lounge was a showcase started by my man, Danny Castro, my man, Anthony Marshall, where they would have a bunch of artists come through and just showcase their talent. And, you know, Lyricist Lounge was the place where I first saw Rod Digger and Biggie and Big Pun, and these people who I saw, you know, just live on stage before they had record deals and everything. And everything was together. At this point in hip-hop, you was down by law. It wasn't like, there wasn't all these different separate factions of hip-hop, like, well, I only listen to commercial rap, or I only listen to this. It was like, you know, if it's dope, it's dope. I used to work for a lady named Jessica Rosenbaum, who is still doing clubs, but she was doing clubs heavy back then. She was doing The Tunnel and A Limelight and Tavern on the Green, and she used to manage Funkmaster Flex, and she was Diddy's partner. So I was going to these, I was doing this underground hip hop in the parks. And I was going to these clubs with people popping bottles, and I'm rubbing elbows with these rappers, and I'm making acquaintances with them. And I'm in college at the same time, and I was working at Shakespeare Company Books in the Village. And the music just won out. You know, the music won out, and I decided to just put all my eggs in the rap basket, because I felt like what I was learning in the park, I felt like it was making me better than what I was hearing on the radio and the rappers I was seeing before. Me striving to better myself at that time, even like back to when I was in high school, even when I was in high school, I got sent away to boarding school for cutting. I cut class all the time. But even when I cut class, I was on the train reading Malcolm X and Dick Gregory and stuff like that. We would cut class and go see Al Sharpton speak about Tawana Brawley, or we cut class and walked across the bridge to march in protest of the murder of Yusuf Hawkins and Bensonhurst. So that political engagement was always there from the family. When I got to college, same thing, I'm going out to all these clubs and doing all this, you know, all this club stuff. But when I got a chance to rap on stage, the content was still there. I never saw a difference between what I was doing and what the Lox and Puff and Biggie and them was doing. But you know, many people did. The people who did not come up in those era to see how Biggie grinded it out, how Puff grinded it out, they see these artists when they get on top. And so it's like they become removed from the situation. But that lesson was taught to me when I came out on Ruckus, and people automatically put us in separate boxes. I remember doing a Lyricist Lounge show 2 or 3 weeks after Biggie passed away, and Puff came to the show, and he had been a supporter of Lyricist Lounge the whole time. But as you know, he's now rich and famous, and he got booed, and the crowd was booing him, and they stood up for him. Danny and Anthony stood up for him. But I remember around that time there was a divide, and people kept pitting me and Mos Def and what we did against mainstream hip-hop, against commercial hip-hop, as if we are not all young black people doing the same thing. I got a lot more in common than a Jay-Z and a Puffy than differences. There's way more similarities to these people than differences. But hip-hop is such a moneymaker now that we play up the differences. And we do all of it a disservice. There's probably a kid who probably could really use some inspiration from our music who may never hear it because he's told us to be put in a conscious box, you know? Now, being called a conscious artist is a compliment. It's one of the greatest compliments that I could receive, to be called an uplifting, conscious, spiritual artist. However, it doesn't define who I am. And if I let what journalists and what people who have to put my music in a package to sell it, if I let what they define me as become what I define myself as, then I'm really limiting myself, I'm really destroying myself as an artist. So while I accept that and I wear it with pride, I also let it be known that I'm an artist first and I'm an advocate for art. The reason why I'm even speaking to you here now is not because I'm conscious, It's because I've worked hard on my craft. It's because it's dope. That's why you even care about what I got to say. If I was whack and conscious, y'all wouldn't care. You know what I'm saying? So it's about the packages and the containers and the boxes and the mediums in which you deliver something. Can hip hop really be a vehicle for a social change? Certainly. Me, what I was doing, the type of hip hop I was doing around that era, plugged me in with a lot of, when I first got signed to Ruckus, plugged me in with a lot of organizations, most namely Refuse and Resist, who was dedicated to the freedom of Mumia Abu-Jamal, and to Malcolm X grassroots movement, which was dedicated not just to Mumia, but to all political prisoners. And, you know, hooking up with Malcolm X grassroots movement, I went to Cuba. We took hip-hop festivals to Cuba, hip-hop festivals to South Africa, and I was able to see how firsthand hip-hop and a hip-hop way of life and a hip-hop mentality have real-world effects. The next time I saw how hip-hop had real-world effects is getting stopped at the airport for listening to Stokely Carmichael's speech. I detail it in this movie, Black Power Mixtape. If you have cable, I advise you go check that out on demand. I think that's the easiest way you can see it. But I told a story about getting stopped by the FBI at the airport because they overheard on the phone conversation I was having that I was listening to a Stokely Carmichael speech. And it just struck me how this was in 2004 when like 50 Cent was on top of the world. And it just struck me how a rapper listening to a Stokely Carmichael speech is more threatening to the government than gangster rap, you know? And the It just let me know that my participation in conscious hip hop is not taken for granted. When Amadou Diallo was shot 41 times, I was on Ruckus. We did a record dedicated to Diallo called 41 Shots. We had all the rappers who were popular at the time hop on the record. We had Organized Noise from Outkast fame produced the track. We shot a video for it. Nobody played this record. And it was disheartening to me for a little bit until somebody came up to me in the street and was like, yo, before I heard that record, I never thought that I could be a conscious artist. I never thought I could make conscious music. And I just had never heard the example. So my job as an artist is not to tear down other artists. My job as an artist is to provide the example. You know, if an artist makes music that I can't relate to, I just don't support that artist. I spend more time supporting the artist that I can relate to. If the radio is not playing songs I can relate to, I turn it off. You know, because the more I turn it on while I was playing those songs, the more the songs are gonna keep playing. I'm very much, you know, a student of hip hop. And I owe hip hop a lot, but I can't look at myself in the context of hip hop when it comes to solving the problems in our community. It's no accident that I always use the word vehicle or tool for hip hop. You won't hear me saying I live and die for hip hop. You know what I'm saying? I don't live and die for hip hop. You know, the problems in our community are so much deeper than an artist or an art form can do to solve. And what we have to do is we have to work on those problems so that hip hop, like I said, is a voice of the struggle, just like any good art, can respond to these things. I'm not someone who tell you to go vote. It don't matter who you vote for. Just go vote. Do your part. That's bullshit. Don't believe anybody who tells you that. Don't believe anybody who tells you the lesser of two evils is, that's bullshit. If you don't know what you're voting for, you're doing the same amount of damage as not voting. You know, you have to be informed. You have to make informed decisions. So I think our effort should not be using hip hop to mobilize people to vote. We should do that, you know, we should do that, but that shouldn't be what the focus of our effort is. The focus of our effort is to create candidates that are worth voting for. You know what I'm saying? Like, when there's a lot of people who like Barack Obama, for better or for worse, whether you like him or not, whether you think he has done a good job or not, he was a dynamic force that people had never seen before, you know, and people voted for him. They didn't vote for the system. They didn't vote for the Democrats. They voted because they placed their faith in that person. And he's someone who was raised in the hip-hop generation. You know, we need to raise people like that that'll speak to our efforts and support them. I could go on and on about how you support conscious artists. I think you should. But I think it's way more important to support conscious movements, conscious people, that would inspire consciousness. I don't know. How long are we talking for? that's basically my spiel, you know, and as we start to talk amongst ourselves, I would like to hear what you guys are doing. And since we're talking about hip hop and hip hop for social change and making hip hop better, what you guys are doing to participate in hip hop, because complaining about the state of hip hop does nothing if you're not actively participating in it. When I say actively participating in it, I mean buying records, I mean making hip hop music, going to hip hop shows, you know, spending time and energy reading up and studying hip hop. You know, if you're not doing that, you don't have a say so. You don't have a right to critique it. You're not down at all. So, you know, that's what I want to hear from y'all, and the question to answer is how y'all participated in hip hop. To make it be more of an active agent for social change. I appreciate y'all time and I look forward to talking to you. I'm about to get some water because I can wait. Yeah.
You have water.
Yeah,
you want your bottle of water?
You want time?
I'll take mine.
We're going to start taking questions now, so if you guys could just raise your hand and I'll run the mic to you.
Or speak loudly so we can all hear you.
Oh, good.
Mrs. Kweli, I got a question. Got two questions for you.
How you doing? What's your name?
Jason.
What's up?
He's nervous.
I remember back in 1999 when you and Mos Def first like separated. He once said that the state of hip hop has to do with the state of people. And that was like 12 years ago, maybe. How do you feel about the state of hip hop now as it correlates to people?
Yeah, I think that's one of my favorite quotes by Mos Def, actually. You know, he talks about, he said this, people ask him, where's hip hop going? It's going wherever the people are going.
Right.
And that's the point I was making earlier about the people being the leaders. I think he's completely on point with that. And I don't think that's limited to hip hop. I think that's for all good music.
And the second question, can we expect another Black Star album anytime soon?
I wouldn't hold your breath for an album, but we can go on Black Star Hub. We drop songs. We dropped 2 songs in the last few months. We tour all the time. We do shows all the time. We just haven't put together an album, so I don't want to promise an album and one don't come out. But there's new Black Star music out there, and there's tours and stuff coming out.
Tell him I said hi,
though. His name is Yasin Bey. I gotta train myself to say that. Most change his name to Yasin Bey.
Raise your hand.
What's going on?
What's up?
All right, this is gonna take a while for me to explain.
I mean, your name. Y'all gotta say your name.
My name is Daniel.
What's up?
Some artists, you watch them develop and evolve. You know, some artists start as struggle artists, if you will. Struggle meaning they're talking about making it to a better place. And then they become successful and they're in the mainstream medium and their focus isn't really on change as much as when they started. So I don't want to name like names of artists, but how do you feel about artists that you've worked with and they've hit mainstream success and they're not really talking about subject matters.
You talking about Kanye?
Yeah.
It's funny because I was thinking that because I DJed this club in Miami last night. And I just got the record, Kanye record, Mercy, with 2 Chainz and Big Sean and push the T on that.
Yeah.
And the records are fucking monster.
Yeah. They're dope. They sound dope.
It's crazy. But I was listening to Ye verse, and I think he said something about make more in your rant or something like that.
Yeah.
And It got me thinking. You know, I was thinking about that line. You know what I'm saying? Like, one, first of all, Kanye West is a good friend and one of the most brilliant artists of our time. And I think he's an incredible lyricist and one of the best producers ever in history. But there's two things. One, your lifestyle changes, and you struggle with an artist and how to be honest about that. I brought Kanye West on tour. And when I was on tour, he was the same level of arrogant. He just didn't have as much stuff to talk about. Like, he was on tour talking about, I'm the best rapper, I'm the best dresser. Yeah. He didn't have no deal. You know what I mean? Like, the things he said now, he said them back then. All of it. Like, he was deaf. So I can't even, when I see him doing it, I'm like, that's the same thing. There's no change.
But, like, you look at artists like, let's say, Lupe Fiasco, and he's more political at this point in his career. He's evolved to sort of a more political subject matter in his music. But it's still, like, you can tell it's geared towards changing something in the black community and in America in general. And Kanye is still materialistic.
But see,
I mean, it's cool.
I bet it's different. Like, when Kanye came out, Kanye had a record. I don't even remember the name of it. It was a record that didn't go on College Dropout. But he had a lyric like, oh, some more golly, some more that bullshit ice rap. Yeah. Gotta apologize for most quality. Yeah. That was what he was saying back then was, I rap about bullshit. I hang out with most Devin Quali, but you might hear me get on some bullshit. That's he said it in the record 15, 12 years ago, right? So now I hear this record, Mercy, where he's rapping about some bullshit, right? It sounds great though, right? But I listen to Watch the Throne, and I could count 4, 5, 6 records on that are conscious records, that are dealing directly with the black community, that are dealing directly, I mean, almost to a fault. These records are so black, it's almost like, how do you make a record this black? So I think he does give the balance, and I think he's been very consistent as an artist. He's the same. He gave his workout plan. He gave his Jesus walks. You know, I think he's been doing it consistently from the beginning. I think Lupe has the same as consistently been Lupe. When Lupe first came out on, was it Touch the Sky? Was the first record he was on? His content, his verses, is about the same as back then. And I think Kanye. The thing Kanye did was Kanye was equally influenced by what artists like myself or Moses doing on the underground as he was by what Cam and Jay-Z was doing at the time. And he was the first person to really, on a successful level, bring those worlds together. And I think he's been very consistent at that.
Also, what do you think about Kendrick Lamar?
I think Kendrick Lamar is one of the most exciting artists I've heard in a long time. I saw Kendrick Lamar before on stage in Los Angeles. He sold the place out. And Dr. Dre, Snoop, Corrupt, The Game, J-Rock, you know, all these people was there, came on stage. It was just crazy. And Kendrick's on my next single, so look out for my next single. It's called Push Through. It's featuring Currency and Kendrick Lamar.
Do you want to come to the Spring Music Fest this Friday? Kendrick Lamar is headlining.
I heard. I'm in Lawrence, Kansas on Friday.
Oh,
yeah.
Hi, my name is Kay. I'm an educator for middle school youth out in West Harlem. My question to you would be, how could we use hip-hop to motivate these children that do not have the privilege of having two parents or educated parents in order to push them forward and to understand that being educated and being informed and just making intelligent choices is important for A, their future, and B, like, just to be a productive member of society?
I think as an educator, you have a unique position because you have a platform. And I think it's about getting people to understand the culture of hip-hop as opposed to just what they're being sold. Too often people associate what they're being sold as the whole culture of hip-hop. So a lot of the complaints about hip-hop, you know, I hate hip-hop, hip-hop sucks. No, it doesn't. You know, it doesn't suck at all. Kendrick Lamar is a perfect example of it. But people get caught up in what they hear on the radio because that's what on TV, that's what being sold to them. But it's false because even the stuff you hear on the radio and TV is like we equally as caught up in the flashing lights as people we criticize. Because that stuff is not selling records, you know what I'm saying? It just looks nice. You know, and you hear it in the clubs. You know, someone might sell a million downloads of a ringtone, but no one's really invested in those artists the same way people are invested in artists like Kendrick Lamar. So it's getting, I think working with kids is taking them to events and getting them to look at things that talk about the rudiments of the culture. Like examining lyrics and examining graffiti and examining b-boy culture and examining the history of hip-hop, making that fun and exciting because it's a fun and exciting history. I think it's that, and also exposing them to other artists, and even in today's times, getting them to understand that they cannot just get their content from TV or radio. Opening their minds to the internet, to here in New York City, man, you could go to Manhattan and see all different types of wonderful artists doing their thing. You know, the artist who depends on radio and TV for success is a fool, and the fan who gets all their information from radio TV is a fool too. You're right. I've been extremely blessed to have both my parents, first of all, and for my parents to be educators. This is something that I'm blessed with, and it defines who I am as an artist. You know, you look at somebody like 50 Cent's parents are drug dealers. You know, he raps like the child of drug dealers. I rap like the child of professors. You know, it doesn't make what I do more valid, or what he does. It doesn't. You know, it just is different sides of the same coin. But I think you do have a unique opportunity as an educator to bring in everything that's not being sold to them. Mm-hmm. Wow.
My name is Matt.
A
couple things. One, when you talk about, you know, we control the radio, we control TV, you know, most of us here, since we all go to St. John's, that means we have a lot of money to spend on stuff, because most of it's going to our education. By that I mean you all have some nice student loans. So we at least have some money to put towards something. But when you're talking about kids who are growing up in West Harlem, you're talking about people who may or may not have the expendable cash to spend on CDs or to go to a concert. Now me, I've introduced my friends to a lot of artists, I've gone to a lot of concerts, but at the same time, if I had paid for every song on my iPod, I would have spent $30,000. So, I mean, what would you say in that case? Would you rather us, you know, download and bootleg music, or would you rather us listen to the radio to music that we actually can't stand?
Well, those are two separate questions. When I say you control it, I'm not talking about with your dollars. You know, that certainly is a very important factor. But what I'm talking about is, the fact of the matter is, look, Hot 97 in New York City, right? Every time I've ever put out a record, Hot 97 has supported me. They're a corporate station, they're owned by Emerson, but they're a personality-driven station. So you have people like DJ Enough and Angie Martinez, who've been on the radio for years, who were on the radio and they playing Gangsta and Tropical Quest records on the radio. And so they got respect for it, you know? And so you hear it, they try to slip it in when they can. They try to do their job, and they try to slip it in when they can. I can tell you for a fact, Hot 97 has always been supportive of me as an artist. But the people, the conscious voice, is not listening to Hot 97. The people who mess with me, they're not listening to it. It's 12-year-old to 25-year-old girls who are calling in to request records. These are not people who are necessarily buying these records. They're just calling in to their, I like Trey songs, I want to hear Trey songs. You know? That's not something to be mad at. It's not a conspiracy. It's just a fact of life. So when I say the people control the airwaves, I'm not just talking about college-educated people. I'm talking about the 14-year-old girl who wanted to hear Travis Porter. She's the people, too. So we just have to acknowledge the changes in hip-hop, the changes in the trends. With y'all still young in college, but my generation got to acknowledge the changes in our age. You know, people are nostalgic for hip-hop. The era I come from, was it better on the radio when they was playing Mobb Deep and Wu-Tang?
Yes.
That lyrical content was just as ratchet, you know. They was talking about busting their guns, smacking up women, you know, selling drugs, all that. But it just, it's the youth, they from New York, and a sound and emotion that you can relate to as people who are here, you know, people who are East Coast. So, I was answering your first question. You had a second part about the downloading, that's right. This is how I feel about downloading. You support when you can. You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever. I download songs for free. You know, I DJ parties often at this point. I can't afford to buy all these songs, you know? But You know, I buy people's albums. I buy songs I really like. I buy people's albums a few times. I go to shows. Music, you can't judge people based on how you grew up. When I grew up, you had music was, you know, hardware. It was you had to pick it up. Now music is in the air. You can Shazam a song and have it in your phone like that. You know, like, it's just in the air. So you can't be mad at people who grew up in this environment for taking advantage of it. You know, as artists, we have to adapt to the situation. And all I can do is just, I put out free music all the time, and the hope, and it usually pays off for me, is that I put out enough free stuff, and people support me when it counts.
I also just want to thank you, because when I was in middle school, my option was pretty much the radio and MTV and BET. When I got to high school is when I said that, like, the music that was on BET and MTV and the radio didn't resonate. And the first thing I ever picked up that was considered, you know, conscious hip-hop was Train of Thought. And I haven't looked back. So I appreciate all the effort you've put in.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I mean, right there. I just need to know you.
My name is Corey. I have two questions. The first one is, genres of music, they're socially constructed. And nowadays, genres is almost like splitting hairs, whether you're conscious hip-hop, normal hip-hop, mainstream, electro-pop, electric, it's all splitting hairs now. So why do you think that something like conscious hip-hop is so stigmatized in mainstream music industry?
I think because the conscious voice and people who are conscious who are in the hip-hop generation have been duped to believe that it's us against them. So they don't participate in it. They're quick to diss music. You know, they're quick to, like you know, Drake is a great example, right? Here's an artist who started out a mixtape scene, didn't have a record deal, and for all intents and purposes, became successful by talking about attempting to be honest with his emotions and his feelings about whatever chick he was dating on his record, right? He was also talking about his love for underground groups, like Little Brother and Slum Village. These are the groups that Drake was influenced by and talking about, as well as talking about being influenced by Houston and the Screw sound, this and that. And he grinded on his own, he put it on his MySpace blog. Everything that people said they wanted, not corporate, independent, not talking about bullshit, not busting a gun, not trying to sell me no. Everything people said they wanted, they had in this artist, and the women liked him first, and they even sang it too. You know what I'm saying? So the chicks liked him first, a couple of dudes was hating because the chicks liked him first, but then the dudes listened to the mixtape, and like, oh, he's really spitting. You know what I'm saying? But then when he got on, and he got signed, and his music is so accessible that you hear artists like Drake literally hear him 10 times in an hour, someone who didn't have that experience with the mixtapes was so far gone. The first time they heard Drake was on Forever. The first time they heard him was on a Baby record, a Timbaland record or something. And they're like, oh, who is this Drake? Whoa, yeah. And that, now he's repping Young Money, which is an entity that a conscious hip-hop fan has already decided is the enemy. You know what I'm saying? I'm not fucking with him. So it causes an interesting thing where it's like, we're so caught up in the brand and the personality, we're not listening to what he's trying to do in the music. You know, the same thing with the Watch the Throne album. Like, I don't know what other album everybody else is listening to, but when I listen to Watch the Throne, I hear a lot of positive, uplifting content. I hear a lot of decadence and some bullshit, too. You know? But that's what I mean, that Jay-Z and Kanye have been giving you that the whole time. This album, they actually came with a lot more uplifting content. And I see them as artists, I see them trying, but people so caught up in the branding and in the personalities of it, people ain't even hearing what they're trying to do. That becomes secondary because we're now selling personalities.
All right, and my second question is, given documentaries like Black Power Mixtape, or more applicable, South Asian Revolution, music can play an important role in social change the same way people can. You look at songs like Aretha Franklin, Roses to a Rose, Lauryn Hill, Social Drugs, Love is Blind by Eve, and all these things covered issues that were relevant during that time period. What do you see as our issue and our struggle for our generation? How do you think music is going to relate to that?
Well, one thing that's great about this generation is activism is coming back and protesting is coming back. You know, for a long time, protest movement was looked at as something weak, something frail, something that didn't really have an effect on things. But with social networking, with what happened in Tunisia and and Egypt and Tahrir Square and the Arab Spring and what those people were able to do in those countries was like the shot heard around the world. And now all of a sudden you see the direct result of that is the Occupy movement. You know, I went down, I got involved in Occupy because Lupe Fiasco was tweeting about it all the time. But he tweets about a lot of courses. I didn't realize it was an ongoing thing. Then Immortal Technique is another artist I respect. I saw he was down there. I'm like, if Immortal Technique and Lupe paying attention to it, I need to pay attention to it. And so that was how I got influenced by it. I went down there, and I was so moved that I shot a video down there for a song I had called Distractions that y'all could check out when y'all get some free time. But, you know, I see our role in music is to play up, like globalization is like a corporate term they use to get all the money, you know? But the flip side of that is dealing with putting everybody's issues on a world scale. You know, I just finished reading Malcolm X's book that Men in Marabu wrote. And one thing that he focused on that wasn't focused on in the autobiography was Malcolm's quest to raise what was happening to black people in America above the civil rights issue and make it a world issue and bring it to the UN. Because only when we deal with it as a world community is when it really can make some change. And it's not, and it's, I also want to add, it's not just about social networking. It can't be. That's why that Kony 2012 was some bullshit. You know what I'm saying? It's about bodies being there. The social networking is just like the hip hop. It's not the revolution, it's the tool. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a tool to get there. But in Egypt, they didn't change the world by tweeting. They changed the world by showing up and staying there in that square. That's how they changed the world.
All right.
It'll be broadcast online.
I'm Mr. Kweli, my name is Bosco, and
what's up?
I would like to ask you, why do you think nowadays rap music has become more like a tool for money and wealth and not art like it used to be? And a lot of new artists tend to forget that rap music is used to be and should be more socially conscious and lyrically rich. And just they focus more on just stuff like money and women and something very light.
Well, we gotta remember, when hip-hop first started, hip-hop didn't start as a tool for consciousness and to spread a message. Hip-hop started so you can go to the party and shake your ass. You know, that was how hip-hop started. When the first rappers came, and hip-hop became a revolutionary tool when you have people like Africa Bambaataa, who was able to transform the Zulu Nation from a street gang to a musical entity, you know? But even it took years after Bambaataa did that for hip-hop to really become a vehicle for social change. When you think about Grandmaster Caz and Busy B, the MCs who really invented the style of rapping that we can all trace our roots to back now, they was rapping about flashy cars and fast women and having fun, popping champagne, the same subject matter that's on hip-hop on the radio now. So we've got to be careful to automatically think rap has always been some revolutionary tool and that kids have forgotten. Because how can they forget something they never knew? You know what I'm saying? The only way they can forget it is if they my age. You know, but if they 17 years old, Biggie is mad old school. You know what I'm saying? So they don't forget, they just doing what they know. That's why when you have an artist, like when you have people like Kendrick Lamar and J. Cole and artists like this who grew up in this era but still strive to give you something more, you gotta support those artists a lot because they're coming up under an entire different circumstance. It's not trendy to be like that. So when they like that and they still able to get it cracking, you gotta step back and be like, wow, okay. You know, and did I answer your question? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think you're right. I'm just saying that the focus should be not on how to get famous by with using rap, but how to create, send your message, deliver your message, and just get people to listen what you're gonna say, like art.
Yeah, I think the focus should be on art because when you become passionate about your art, other things start to matter. You know. A lot of people get into music because they just, it's a hobby and they just, you know, it's a distraction, and then when they get more into it, they start taking it seriously, it changes them. It's always great to see an artist change. That's what the tragedy of Tupac and Big was. Because they both shot when they murdered when they was 25. imagine what they would be rapping about the artists they are now. You know, it's like hearing Jay-Z song about his daughter. You know, it's about the thought that Jay-Z would even be having a daughter and, you know what I'm saying, getting married and stuff like that. Like, you know, he wasn't that dude 15 years ago. You know, but it's exciting to see artists grow and change. Artists should be allowed to develop.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Tiffany.
Hi, Tiffany.
I wanted to know how you felt about female MCs and how they have to be sexualized to be accepted mainstream. Because I know a lot of them, you know, we don't have like the Queen Latifahs and MC Lights like back then. So why has it shifted so much, and what has made like the public accept them more?
Well, you know, hip hop as a microcosm for the real world is a boys club, and female artists, the most successful female artists, with the exception of your MC Lights and Latifahs, your Little Kims, Foxy Brown, Nicki Minaj, have, you know, it's like when you think like a man, you know, it's like they more manly than the men, you know, they gotta be more sexual, and you know, they gotta outdo the men at their own game, and you know, it's interesting to watch, because I feel like just being by the nature of women, women hear music and feel music more than men do. And by that, female MCs have an advantage over male MCs as soon as they pick up the mic, because they're more connected to nature. Women are more connected to nature. So it's easier for women to just flow and just hop into music than a dude in general. So you should be see a lot more female MCs coming up. But I think the important thing is to not be caught up in just what's going on the radio, because there are a lot of female MCs out there who could use our support. My favorite MC in the world is Jean Grey. And Jean Grey is a female MC who is better than every rapper. You know, she just never had a major label release. My label, Blacksmith, we've been attempting to get a release for her. You know, there's Rhapsody out of North Carolina. There's Psy-Rock out of Atlanta. You know, there's a lot of people out there, but I think what we just have to do is really, really, really put our support behind these artists and talk about them as much as possible.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have to wrap up soon because we have another event against that's hand, so we're going to have just two more questions the most, all right? I apologize. So we have one right
here. Hi. Hello. What's the call? Hi, my name is Joan, and you mentioned that you went to Cuba. And living in New York, the Latin American presence here is just as strong as the African American community. So, and I've traveled to some Latin American countries, and I've seen the fusion of music genres like jazz and, you know, the Afro-Cuban, Afro-Brazilian, Afro-Colombian presence is very strong there. How do you feel, or how do you see the Latin American presence affecting hip-hop?
Latin American what affecting hip-hop?
Presence.
Well, I mean, you know, hip-hop was born in the Bronx, you know what I'm saying? I mean, hip-hop come from Black and Latino kids in the Bronx, you know, and just the makeup of the Bronx itself, hip-hop is equally a Black and Latino art form. That's just what it is. You know, I remember having a discussion with someone who told me Fat Joe is not real hip-hop. I'm like, dude, is a Puerto Rican dude from the Bronx, you know what I'm saying? Like, he was in Digging in the Crates crew. He's down with Showbiz and AG. I don't care what record he did. You can't get more hip hop than somebody like him. So I mean, I think Latino culture has always been a huge, huge influence on hip hop. It's an influence on me myself now. Going to Cuba. I spent a lot of time in Puerto Rico, dealing with bamba music and working with artists down there for sounds of my album. You know, I can't be separated. It's just there.
Okay. Tarek, you said to say something that I do for hip hop.
What you said?
You said to say something that I do for hip hop. I write, I spit, go to New Rican, buy records, listen to the old stuff. But anyway, I just wanted you to think about these three quotes, all right? There was Mos Def who said, screaming brand new, yet we sanitize the old shit. There was another one by Beanie when he said, he never thought about rap until he copped his deal. And Nas, simply, hip-hop is dead. Mm-hmm. Now, can you analyze those quotes real quick?
Okay, first one, what do you say?
Screaming brand new, yet we sanitized the old shit.
That's what these are tonight, right?
I
think he was talking about just the idea that nothing is new under the sun. That every idea you had is recycled, it comes from something. And so you can't be out there like, oh, I'm brand new this. Nothing is really brand new. You got it from somewhere. And you have to acknowledge where you got it from. Instead of recycling the stuff and presenting it as something new. The next one was Beans, you said?
Yeah, Beanie Siegel. This dude said he never thought about rap until he copped his deal.
Okay. Beans used to sell crack. Then he's got a rap deal and stop.
And last one, Nas, hip-hop is dead.
The mentality that's associated with people who don't participate in hip-hop is a dead mentality. You know, it goes for the people who listen to all that bullshit, and it also goes for people who criticize artists who are in the top 10 or criticize commercial music without delving into that artist's struggle. And so, I don't think hip-hop can ever be dead because there's so much hip-hop that we're not hearing, you know? There's so much hip-hop that we're not hearing, so much hip-hop that's not being taken into account. And also, just me as an artist, I know I'm still alive.